How are you making sure that your secrets are securely stored so that you can avoid data breaches as well as chaos in your DevOps workflows? Hi, I'm Alex Greer with the IBM Cloud team. And before I get started, make sure to like and subscribe. Now, what is a secret? A secret is a digital credential that is going to allow entities to communicate and perform actions on a service. This discrete piece of information keeps that access point secure. So let's take a look at the way in which this paradigm exists. So let's start with an entity here needs to access some sort of service. We'll leave it a little ambiguous for right now, but some sort of service. So in order to properly communicate with this service and be able to take the action that it needs to get its job done, this entity is going to need to communicate to this service two things. One, who it is. So that service can understand what or who it's interacting with. Two, it's going to have to know the set of permissions that it should grant in the context of its service. With these, the service can now properly allow that entity to interact with them. So how we enable this is with something we call a secret. So now with this dynamic established, let's move into an example with users. So for users, we'll say user here is our entity, and we'll say our service here, let's just say it's a developer and they happen to need read or write access. So they're interacting with a development repo in order to do that. So in order to gain that access, again, coming back to the need, we have authorization and permission. How it's going to communicate it specifically in this circumstance is by giving it user credentials. Now, that user can interact with that dev repo in the way that they need to get their job done. Now, looking at a cloud native application story, we have a lot of microservices that have to talk to each other. So let's look at that. So let's just call it service A needs to interact with a database called DB and grab a piece of specific information that it needs to get its job done. So what it needs in the form of a secret here is what we call dbconfigs. Again, this dbconfig is going to allow it to have the right communication with the service saying, this is who I am, and this is what I came here to accomplish. But now that we have our user credentials and our dbconfigs as an example of secrets, we realize the vulnerability that can be created here if these were to fall into the wrong hands. And this is why it's so important to establish a centralized place to manage all these things as we build out more and more applications, microservices, and we have more of these, that problem becomes more complex. And if it falls into the wrong hands, how is it protected? How did we block it from getting to that point? How was that data isolated? When we look at the damage that this can cause, we're looking in the millions of dollars, for example, for a data breach. And in terms of developer operations, if you're not properly managing these, forget even the case in which a bad actor hasn't been involved, but it can be confusing for teams to use this. So what we need to do is make sure that we have it, again, centralized and properly stored so that we can leverage these secrets in the right way and they can properly communicate with services. Okay. Now let's take a look at the next layer of the onion in a more complicated example. Now, let's go back to Jane, the enterprise developer. Jane, we'll say eDev here, needs again to have access to that development repo that she was referring to earlier. Let's just go ahead and call this, maybe it's GitHub. So what she needs to be able to do is have write access. And so she's going to need to request the information that's going to give her access to that write role. So that's where a secrets manager service comes in a perfect complementary fashion. So a secrets manager service can securely store these credentials along with other types of secrets in a centralized way for her to be able to access, or maybe other services to access, like we'll see in a second. But what it's done is it's given her the peace of mind that her user credentials are securely stored, and now she can worry about authenticating and with the service and getting her job done, because Secrets Manager is going to take care of that for her. However, what's really important for a Secrets Manager service to do is interact with the cloud service provider's IAM, or Identity and Access Management Service. So this IAM is going to be the source of truth, allowing Secrets Manager to, one, authenticate who she is and so that it can pass it down to GitHub, and secondarily, also allow for her to get the right set of roles based on the paradigm that they have within their IAM service. So with this, we now understand what it's like for a user to get the right permission and be able to access the tool of their choice or their service, and be able to do this in the context of using a Secrets Manager service. But now let's look what it's like for a service to interact with another service and potentially where data breaches could be harmful. Now let's look at our service-to-service example. So what we have to start with is that we have, let's just call it a lending application. So lending app. And this lending app is going to want to request permissions to be able to access. Again, we were talking about a database earlier. Let's be a little bit more specific. This database that it needs to access and a given table within this database has necessary information to give to its model in order to be able to make a judgment on whether or not they want to provide a consumer a loan. So we're going to call this a profile database. So within here we have profile DB, and we know that the set of permissions that we want to grant are going to be read permissions for table A. So again, where are we going to store the secret that's ultimately going to give us access, to give us access to authentication and ultimately to the set of permissions that we need here? So that's again going to be the Secrets Manager service provided. And that service needs to talk to Cloud IAM again. So now that we've got this established, what type of credential do we have here? The credential that we have is called a dbconfig. So let's think about the scenario we just walked through. This dbconfig allows this lending application, a service, to be able to have read access or be able to take a specific set of information from a given table within a database that has some IP data and some other highly sensitive information in it. So in a scenario in which these dbconfigs are not stored properly, or the service that they store it in is compromised, what we ultimately get is a pretty catastrophic scenario for the provider. Because the provider of this service, of this lending application, then has to go and tell its customer that a bad actor was able to take advantage of access that it got wrongfully to its dbconfig. And that dbconfig ultimately allowed that bad actor to steal their data and do whatever they wanted with it against that customer. So what we can do to mitigate it, again, is store it in a safe location where bad actors do not have access and you have a level of data isolation that you're comfortable with as an enterprise. So that's where we have Secrets Manager services. So again, Secrets Manager services help to ensure the secure storage of secrets so that you don't have to worry about data breaches from lost credentials or from other types of secrets. And ultimately, it makes it a little more efficient for the management of your secrets while you're going through your DevOps operations. Thank you. If you have questions, please drop us a line below. If you want to see more videos like this in the future, please like and subscribe. And don't forget, you can grow your skills and earn a badge with IBM Cloud Labs, which are free browser-based interactive Kubernetes labs.